Friedrich Schiller, A Genius Finds Words, 1759 to 1783.
Late autumn, 1759. The 10th of November is a Saturday. The weather is dull and rainy. Elizabeth Dorothee Schiller, daughter of the landlord of the Lion and wife of Lieutenant Johann Caspar Schiller, is in labor. On this gray November day, she gives birth to her second child, a boy this time, in this unpretentious little house in Marbach on the Neckar. The child is christened Johann Christoph Friedrich Schiller. Only the first few years of his life will be spent in this very poor little town. His mother is a bright, charming young woman, of an independent turn of mind, as far as that is possible in a marriage of this period. His father, a remarkably serious man, according to a contemporary description, is a doctor in the Duke of Württemberg's army. And as there's a war raging in Germany, he's away from home on active service. What sort of a world is it that young Schiller has been born into? Marbach is in Württemberg, one of the many small states that make up the German Empire. The ruler of Württemberg is Duke Karl Eugen, a man who's much feared. Prussia and Austria have been at war for 3 years. They are fighting over Silesia, a rich grain-producing region which belongs to Austria, but which Friedrich II of Prussia is eager to incorporate into his own state. Karl Eugen's troops are on the side of the Empress of Austria. There's widespread devastation. The only beneficiaries of the war are those countries that have no part in it. The population is divided into three so-called estates: the nobility, the bourgeoisie, and the peasantry, who were mostly serfs, and were often treated as no better than slaves. There's a vast gulf between rich and poor, and many live on the verge of starvation. Usury is rife. Child labor is a widespread evil. The German rulers all have eyes only for France, where Louis XV reigns, and his mistress, the Marquise de Pompadour, holds court. The king divides his time between hunting, womanizing, and hosting brilliant court occasions. The German princes do their best to emulate him. Europe, meanwhile, enjoys a welcome respite. England launches a wave of new economic thinking. And France, a new philosophy. Jean-Jacques Rousseau and Voltaire awaken hopes that man may be coming to his senses. The result is a new sense of hope and optimism. The writer Gottfried Ephraim Lessing and the philosopher Immanuel Kant introduce enlightenment to Germany. People are full of expectations and confidence. Universities and schools are founded. Reading circles and cultural societies are established. In the light of the new ideas, reality appears even more miserable and wretched. The new confidence breeds of dissatisfaction. There are calls for progress and change. In 1764, Schiller's father gets another posting. The family moves to Lorch, a village in the rural Ems Valley, and discover the simple pleasures of country living. For the time being, neither elevated hopes nor harsh realities disturb the tranquility of Schiller's life. His early experiences are simply idyllic. He has complete trust in man and beast, in God and the world. God, as he learns from going to church every Sunday, and from the way people think in those days, is a benign but firm authority who guarantees the order and the reasonableness of the world. Everything is perfectly clear. God watches over man's entry into this world and his exit from it. He's the Lord of creation. Adam and Eve have brought sin into the world. But whoever is guilty of sin is punished. Another benign authority is Pastor Mose, who preaches on Sundays from this pulpit. 15 years later, Schiller will write him into his play, The Robbers, his own way of setting up a memorial to the respected cleric. Mose taught him to read and write, instructed him in Latin, and at the age of 6 or 7, taught him the rudiments of Greek. Friedrich would sometimes play at sermons. His sister remembers.
As a 6-year-old, he would climb up on a chair with a black apron wrapped around him and preach a sermon. At the least sign of irreverence, he would get very angry. He would take as his text something that had actually happened, or a saying that he would interpret. He would, deeply, earnestly, and already eagerly, be determined to get at the truth.
Throughout his life, Schiller would retain a vivid memory of the Idyll of Lorch, but it was not to last. In 1766, his father, a captain by now, is transferred to Ludwigsburg. The family's few possessions are loaded onto a cart. Mother and children climb up alongside, and that's the last they will see of the village, the countryside, and the happy years of childhood. Their new home is the city, the ducal residence. A world of periwigs, courtiers, patricians, traders, taverns, officers and their lady friends, the dwellings of the rich, and the house that will be theirs. Above all, the castle. Behind those windows resides the much-feared Duke. It won't be long before young Schiller gets a chance to see what goes on behind these walls. His father takes him to the ducal opera house, into the world of grand society. Ministers, lackeys, singers from Italy, generals, dancing girls from France, adventurers, desperados, courtesans. A world where people laugh and whore and philosophize, of show stealers and manipulators and liars. With what mixture of fascination and horror must this exceptionally gifted child from the country have observed the brilliance and the lust for life of this rococo world? A soiree with a performance of Billy Wildkluck's new opera, Orpheus and Eurydice. Opera, theatre. Experiences that don't fail to create a deep impression. In 1772, Schiller takes his first steps in the field of tragedy. The Christians and Absalom are dramas with a religious setting. His sketches have unfortunately not survived. Towards the end of that same year, his father is commanded to appear before the Duke. Karl Eugen orders the boy, Friedrich, to be sent to the military academy. The family reacts with consternation. In the end, reluctantly, they agree to sign away their parental rights. From now on, the Duke will fulfill the role of father to the boy. The military academy is later renamed the Karl Eugen High School. It's an institution renowned for its harsh discipline, where future army officers and civil servants are educated and drilled into obedience. Schiller enters the school in January 1773. Once its doors have closed upon a pupil, they open again only for walks taken with a guard. School holidays are unheard of. Leave is never granted. The power of the Duke over the inmates is total and ruthless. The cadets are subjected to a regime of draconian discipline. Up at 5, dress in uniform and regulation peruke. Early roll call, prayers, lessons, drill, noontime roll call. Half an hour in the dining hall, private study. After supper, straight to bed. It's like living in a straitjacket. The curriculum reflects current ideals and standards. They are taught Latin and Greek and also French, mathematics, natural history, history, ethics and religion. Then there are lessons in music, drawing, riding, fencing and dancing. But the pupil's prowess is severely handicapped by the harshness with which the material is taught.
Wann hat er das letzte Mal seine Schuhe putzt? Vor einem Monat. Vor einem Jahr! C'est incroyable! Qu'est-ce que vous croyez? Vous êtes complètement fous!
Schiller will later speak of the insane method of his education. The Duke has total authority. He ordains whether punishment will be the birch, the cane, or being sent to bed without supper. Young Schiller reacts by becoming deeply disturbed. He's frequently ill and his performance is poor. Who is this man in whose name he and his friends are continually beaten and flogged? What kind of moral authority can justify this kind of regime? The young cadet begins to question and his paralysis leaves him. Schiller learns to cope by taking refuge in an elegant hatred. Power, its glamour, its seductiveness, and its misuse will one day become the dramatist's central theme. From one of his teachers, Abel, Schiller acquires a knowledge of Shakespeare's plays. Under the influence of the great English realist, he begins to form his own image of man, which, for all his enthusiasm for the new ideas of the age, is pretty free of illusions. The lilies that he grows at school become a symbol of inner freedom. He accepts humiliation and oppression so that he can pillory them when the time comes. He starts making notes for his robbers. He reads extracts from it to his friends in secret. They are what save him from total despair. With them he can argue and discuss and share his enthusiasm. They laugh and cry together, think together. It's a relationship of closeness and brotherliness, which foreshadows the new one between men, which is being dreamed of everywhere. Schiller's interest shifts from law to medicine. The relation between man's animal nature and his spiritual one is the title of his school-leaving diploma essay. He leaves the cadet school in December 1780 with an appointment as regimental doctor without the rank of officer. In the first days of his rather limited freedom, Stuttgart seems like paradise to him. But this impression quickly fades. Life in the city is ruled by pettiness and conventionality. After only a few weeks, he admits,
"My bones have told me in confidence that they on no account wish to rot in Swabia."
Medicine holds little interest for Schiller. The remedies he prescribes are much feared. Whenever he can, he works on his manuscripts. His living conditions are spartan. He shares a small room with a friend in the house of Louise Fischer, the widow of an army captain. Louise Dorothée Fischer, 33 years old, becomes the recipient of paeans of praise. She's the lady who inspires the poems to Laura. Strangely enough, it's in a poem on the death of a schoolmate from the military academy that Schiller speaks for the first time in the true and vehement voice of the age. Later, this will be referred to as the period of storm and stress. The poem is passed from hand to hand in Stuttgart.
"Clap then, clap your hands and give applause. Dying's a welcome end to fatuous things, and many a grief finds in the graveyard pause. What boots to be a denizen of this world? We are but mountebanks, dissemblers, players, in dubious league with unrelenting death. Then happy who, his brief performance o'er, his mask laid down, to nature turns once more."
In 1781, Schiller has The Robbers printed at his own expense. He sends the first copy to Mannheim. Couched in a new language, The Robbers is a protest against the outmoded spirit of yesterday. Schiller waits anxiously for a reply. His hopes are not disappointed. Wolfgang Heribert von Dalberg, director of the Court and National Theatre in Mannheim, is interested in putting on the play. subject to conditions, though. Schiller has to rewrite parts of the text and set it in the Middle Ages to avoid causing offence. The first performance is in January 1782. Schiller attends without permission from the Duke. The play is about two brothers. Franz resorts to lies and deception in order to oust Karl from his father's affection. With the help of a forged letter, he makes out that their father has disowned Karl. Deeply hurt, Karl has himself proclaimed captain of a band of robbers, a band that's not out for its own gain, but to take up arms against the injustices of the age. It isn't the establishment here that embodies the higher morality, it's the other way round. The robbers are on the side of right, and out to expose the real truth about society.
Ein zuckersüßes Brüderchen in der Tat! Franz heißt die Kanaille.
Von Wasser und Brot ist die Rede. Da hab ich anders für euch gesorgt. Hab ich's nicht gesagt, ich müsste am Ende für euch alle denken.
Was sagt der Schafskopf? Der Esel will am Ende für uns alle denken!
The fearless but brutal bunch of social revolutionaries degenerate rapidly, until in the end they share the fate of all terrorists.
Ich hätte Tränen vergossen. Höre, Moa, was denkst du davon? Ein Räuberleben ist doch auch besser als bei Wasser und Brot im untersten Gewölb der Türme.
Ich hab ihn so unaussprechlich geliebt. Du liebte keinen Sohn. Ich hätte 1000 Leben für ihn.
Genau! Wer mir jetzt ein Schwert in die Hand drückte, dieser Otternbrut eine brennende Wunde zu versetzen, wer mir sagte, wo ich das Herz ihres Lebens erzielen, zermalmen, zernichten kann, der sei mein Freund, mein Engel, mein Gott, ich will ihn anbeten.
Eben diese Freunde wollen wir ja sein, lass dich doch weisen.
Komm mit uns in die böhmischen Wälder, wir wollen eine Räuberbande sammeln.
Und du sollst unser Hauptmann sein. Du musst unser Hauptmann sein.
Stockfisch.
Räuber und Mörder. Das hast du nicht aus deiner Menschenseele hervorgeholt. Wer blies dir das Wort ein? Ja, beim tausendarmigen Tod. Das wollen wir. Das müssen wir. Ich bin euer Hauptmann.
Es lebe der Hauptmann!
Oh, was für ein Tor ich war.
From the start, Schiller's interest is in the nature of man, the structure of his psyche, his unfulfilled potential, the misuse of power that he's capable of. This will guarantee him the interest of readers and theatre audiences for centuries to come.
Dass mir jemals etwas teuer war. Nun, und bei dieser männlichen Rechte schwöre ich euch hier, treu und standhaft euer Hauptmann zu bleiben, bis in den Tod.
From Schiller they learn that power and morality are two different things. Right from the start, Schiller has what it takes to make him a classic of German literature. He writes wonderful dialogue, he understands the human psyche. He uses the German language as a fine and precise instrument. Iffland, one of the greatest actors of the time, plays the role of Franz. The play is a sensational success. The audience is profoundly affected by a work that voices their own deepest instincts. The applause is tumultuous, frantic even. A few days later, Schiller notes,
"If Germany is to find in me a dramatic poet, then last week must count as the start of it."
Schiller is ordered to appear before the Duke. News of the sensational first performance has spread like wildfire. It has reached the ears of Karl Eugen. Schiller gets a very ungracious reception.
"I have been fully informed. You have been in Mannheim. I order you to surrender your sword. You will be placed in detention for 2 weeks. Write another play, and I will have you cashiered."
In detention, Schiller plots his escape. With the words and the voice of the Duke in his ear, he sketches out his third play. Under the title of Love and Intrigue, it's destined to achieve world fame. In it, Schiller will take merciless revenge on the absolutist pretensions of princes and the outmoded values of the political establishment. On the evening of the 27th of September, 1782, Schiller drives out through one of Stuttgart's city gates in the company of a musician friend, Andreas Streicher, with a false name and a forged passport.
Wolf von Dr. Ritter nach Esslinge ausreisen. So, so. Gute Reise.
At a grand party being celebrated in the Duke's palace, the man who sees through him and his like, as no one ever has before, flees from the tentacles of his power. From the road along which they make their escape, the fugitives see the solitude, the palace where the Duke is in residence. Their hearts beat in terror. Fear drives out their exhaustion. They drive all through the night, a night filled with reminiscences, plans, scraps of poetry, scenes from plays not yet written. Dawn comes. They're still anxious lest they should have been followed or their flight discovered. After travelling for 8 hours, the fugitives reach the border to the neighbouring state, the Palatinate. Schiller is free. He has thrown off the Duke's cruel yoke. He contacts friends in Mannheim. They are horrified. They're afraid that the Duke will send his henchmen in pursuit. A letter of Schiller's explaining himself will be of little use, however. They're all tense and anxious. Schiller's second play, Fiesco, set in the Republic of Venice, doesn't find favour. Political freedom is the tragic hero of this play. Without a penny to their name, Schiller and Streicher set out to walk to Frankfurt. Schiller suffers a breakdown. He fails to find a footing in Frankfurt. He writes to Dalberg.
All I can hope for now is that some assistance will be speedily granted to me.
Dalberg refuses to put money into Fiesco. He's unhappy about the Republican bias of the work and is in any case reluctant to risk tangling with the Duke. Schiller's friends advise him to lie low for a while in Oggersheim, a village not far from Mannheim. He spends 2 wretched months here. News reaches him from Stuttgart that he's been declared a deserter. He pawns his watch and sets about trying to work on his notes for Love and Intrigue. He reflects and broods. Streicher sometimes plays to his friend on the portable piano. They lodge at an inn. They're reduced to eating no more than a piece of bread morning and evening and a bowl of watery gruel at lunchtime. Rescue comes when they least expect it. Henriette von Wolfzogen, a motherly friend from the Stuttgart days, offers them hospitality on her estate in Bauerbach in Thuringia. Schiller arrived there on the 1st of December, 1782. He writes to Andreas Streicher.
I've arrived at last, and how happy I am to have reached the shore. I enjoy every comfort here, meals, service, laundry, eating. At the moment, I'm not looking for any new people because I have an enormous amount of work to do.
The tragedy, Love and Intrigue, still at this stage under the title Louise Miller, takes on its final form. A winter idyll. Schiller is safe, and he has time. Every blank page is a challenge. Still working on the completion of one subject, he already feels new ideas crowding in on him. He makes his first notes for Don Carlos and Maria Stuart. All the same, as the long winter continues, the isolation begins to oppress him.
It's a laborious business, this forcing myself to produce a poetry writing mood. I'm longing for the time when the swallows will return to our skies and new sensibilities to my heart.
Work is Schiller's only consolation. The post brings a letter from Mannheim. Dalberg wants to know how the new play is coming along. With the end of winter, visitors arrive in Bauerbach. Frau von Wolzogen. And her 17-year-old daughter. Schiller knows the girl from Stuttgart. When he sees her again, he's convinced he can't possibly live without her. His passionate feelings are not requited. A letter from Dalberg rescues Schiller from his despair. The Mannheim theatre director is interested in him again. It seems he's no longer afraid of the Duke's revenge. When summer comes, Schiller leaves the estate. The firm possibility of a post as resident writer lies ahead. The famous but penniless author of The Robbers has hopes that his years of dependence are at an end.